So tonight's project was a height gauge arm for my twin beam or two beam import height gauge. It's not like a Mitutoyo or anything, but I guess a Mitutoyo is an import gauge too. This one's probably from China or Taiwan. It's an STM brand. I think it's from SOA Tools. That's a Canadian tooling distributor. I actually really like this height gauge though. It's fairly accurate and I really, really like dial height gauges. I know a lot of people use digital ones. I prefer dial height gauges. Vernier ones are good too. I find they're a little bit slower maybe to use just because I'm younger and I'm not that good at reading vernier rules. But I was gonna talk a little bit about height gauges. In the shop, the height gauge is one of my favorite tools. After a decent set of calipers and a decent set of micrometers, both calipers and micrometers, you can get decent ones for not that much money. Height gauges, you will spend a little bit more money on, but if you don't have one, I find them extremely useful. I use them for layout a lot. They're great tools to have. And if you look for import ones, you can find them usually reasonably priced. Or obviously you could also look for a used one, a good used Mitutoyo or something. The Mitutoyo ones in this, I have a 12 inch one. Mitutoyo ones can be quite pricey. Usually between $600 and $700 here, at least that's the last price that I've saw. I think this one, I bought this one a few years ago. It was just over $200, but I use it a lot in the shop and it's a really great tool. What another part of this project that was great was that I got my Christmas present from Max. Thanks, Max. It was this little boring head here and I used it to bore the hole. This is a quarter inch pin here. I used it to bore the quarter inch hole through there instead of using a ream. This boring head is a beautiful piece of work and it's designed very well. One of my favorite things about it is that it uses 3/16 tooling, which is perfect for the mini mill that I have and even maybe something a bit bigger. But 3/16 tooling is great for doing small work. Intricate work, which Max does a lot of, and it shows in the way he put this boring head together. Check this out. I'll get a close-up in the next shot of the adjusting dial just to show some of the detail on it. So here's the adjusting dial that Max made for it. Max made everything, including the screw and that. I guess it's kind of going out of focus there a little bit. But, there's a little slot in it. There. And you can see the dovetail. I'm sure Max will be making a video of him making this. But it was really easy to use and it's like the perfect size for a mini mill. This is so much better than those import boring heads that are oh so common in so many home shops. And most of them, to be honest, are a little too big, at least for the type of work that I do. And they're really too big for a mini mill. This is really, sized perfectly, and it lets you do small bores precisely, and it saves you money on reams. So I bored, that was a quarter inch hole. You can go down 3/16 or even smaller depending on what you do with the tool, but it worked really well. So thanks again, Max. Great work as usual, and check for his build video on it. I'm sure it'll be up soon if it isn't already. But that's well worth watching. So this arm, which I'll show you how I made it in a bit, but the height gauge arms are really important in the shop for measuring stuff like this, which is going to be my next project. Stay tuned. But what I needed to do, and you know, most height gauges are shipped with one of these, like it's like the standard, you know, flat one, and for measuring, you know, flats. And it also has a carbide tip on it for scribing. If you want it, you can use that for layout work, which I commonly do. So for this, I needed to measure the depth on this bore on the inside of this bearing housing here. And the way this thing's manufactured is it references this surface on the outside here. So obviously using, you know, this doesn't work because, yeah, sure, you can reference this surface, but, you know, how are you going to get down in there? So I designed this thing up. They're common on the internet. You can buy them too if you want, but, you know, it sometimes feels like cheating. And this was a good project for one night. Just move Max's boring head over there. So basically, you know, now I can reference this surface with my height gauge, you know, zeroed out, and now I can measure the depth of this bore, or I can measure perhaps this surface, or I can measure down here with it, right? And it's, you know, I made it so you can adjust it. And the other thing that I did was on the ends, they're both threaded. I threaded both ends, and you'll kind of see why I did that. But I threaded it to use, you know, dial indicator ends. I was given a gift by a friend a few years ago with the, you know, one of the import measuring sets, and then it came, you know, I think we might have seen these, but you can buy these kits with all the different indicator ends on them. To be honest with you, the quality on this isn't the greatest. It leaves a lot to be desired. They're poorly made, but it was a gift, and I have them, and I'll put them to use. I may have to remake some of them, but the nice thing is that, and the thread on the end of these indicator ends is usually number 448. It can be a different thread. There's one other thread. It's escaping me right now what that is, but the number 448 is the more common one, and so this allows me to thread different ends on here, and really, it kind of turns your height gauge into sort of, a really, really rudimentary CMM. Now, for heights, obviously. So now you can quickly pick off all these different heights and use that to, for me, I want to reproduce this part in CAD, and I'm kind of designing a new one. So, it was not too bad. We did it one night. There's a few things that I did. This pin, I think I call it the height gauge, or gauge pin. I turned it. It's turned to be within about 3/10 over the diameter on my Chinese lathe. And I'll kind of show you how I did that, or talk about that a little bit. But essentially, I turned it between centers, and I used this pin to dial in my tailstock. So I turned it between centers and set the tailstock over. And I could have got it closer, but I was just getting I just wanted to move on with the project, but it's pretty accurate. And I made a brass thumbscrew here, and I made this arm, and for entertainment purposes, I did this arm, the surfacing of this arm, on the shaper, and you can see that, you know, it leaves a typical beautiful shaper finish. And this is just cold rolled steel, low carbon. It really machines terribly, but with a cheap high speed steel bit and a shaper, you can get really nice surface finishes. And hey, it's just fun to watch the thing work. So why don't we now take a look on how I made this thing. And like I said, thanks again, Max. Max has got a YouTube channel that's way more popular than mine. And I think most of you who are watching me is because of Max. So his blog is The Joy of Precision, and his YouTube channel, I'll put links in the video here as well. But yeah, thanks again, Max. Awesome boring head, and it's gonna get put to really good use here. So let's watch me make the parts. There's three parts to make, and I started with making the pin, or what I'm calling the gauge pin. So I turned and, or I faced and drilled and tapped both sides with a number 448 thread. And baking grease was put to good use. Shop smells great. That's a spiral flute bottoming tab. So what I did here was I turned a center in the three jaw chuck using a piece of scrap material. I generally prefer to do this versus mounting a center in the spindle because it's quite a bit quicker. I don't have to take the three jaw chuck off. So here I'm taking test cuts, and after each cut of the diameter, I'm measuring it using my calipers at first, and then I break out the micrometers for more precision measurements, and I'm setting the tailstock so that the part doesn't turn a taper whatsoever. It takes a number of tries to get it set up exactly, but just to give you an idea, I'm really not moving it more than a couple thousandths of an inch. So on most lathes, the tailstock's adjustable in the X direction of the lathe, or in the direction of the cross slide. And it's adjustable using these little set screws here at the bottom. So the tailstock can shift, you know, towards you or away from you. And when you have a part between centers, so if it's supported here in the center and you've put a center in the spindle, or you've turned a center like I did, you can use the tailstock to turn tapers, or you can dial your tailstock in to not turn tapers. And that's basically what I was doing. I took a test cut, I'd measure it, see what the taper is, and then figure out how much to move the tailstock over, either towards me or away from me. And then I would just mount a dial indicator on here when I set it, just to see how much I was moving it over. And then I would tighten the tailstock back up again, take another test cut, and then just keep repeating it until you get it dialed in.
So I got the pin within about 4/10 over the entire 4-inch length. The part was slightly larger in diameter in the center versus at the ends where it was supported. This was due to the tool pressure causing the part to spring a little bit, and thus it would be larger in diameter in the center. I could have gotten it closer, but I decided to move on with the project. So once I got the tailstock set up, I proceeded to rough the pin down to proper size, leaving only 10 or even maybe less than 10 thou so that I could place it back between centers. Once you take the center out though, you have to retouch it up, and you're seeing me do that here. So I put the scrap center in and then retouched it up, so now it's concentric again, placed the pin between centers, and took the final few passes to get it to the size that I wanted. Now onto the arm portion. I found a piece of scrap flat bar I had and cut it down to size on my bandsaw as I pushed it off camera. I did use a push stick though, don't worry, I didn't cut my fingers. I thought I'd finish this part on my shaper. Shaper work is slow as molasses, but it's a lot of fun to do, and if you can pick up a small bent shaper, I'd recommend it. For tools, I usually just use standard lathe tools, so I grind a lathe geometry on them. I know there are specialty tools for shapers. I haven't really looked into it all that much. I found that turning tools work great, and the surface finish you get from them is really good. Generally, I take about a 30 thou depth of cut on this Ammco 7-inch shaper, which I thought was actually a pretty good depth of cut. So here you can see the surface finish that I got. This is just regular cold rolled low carbon steel, and that can be really, really gummy, so I was really happy with that. And you can do it with really cheap tooling, like these are just high speed steel tool bits. No fancy end mills, no fancy shell mills. So after picking up the height gauge arm using an edge finder, I rough drilled the hole. I spotted it using a spotting drill, not a center drill. I greatly prefer using spotting drills over center drills for this type of work. So if you don't have a spotting drill in your shop, check it out. I highly recommend them. After it was roughed out, I single point bore it to 1/4 inch in diameter using the Joy of Precision's boring head. Worked great. Didn't have to go out and buy a $20 ream. I could just use a high-speed steel single point boring tool that you can grind on your bench grinder. I think my Dutch is really starting to show. So I drilled and then tapped a hole for a 632 thread in the end of the height gauge arm for the screw that'll hold the gauge pin. I usually try to start the taps in the mill itself. I turn it by hand and apply a slight down feed when I do it, but there's a high risk of you breaking the tap, so I take it out and finish it by hand in the vise. But this way it makes sure that the taps at least started straight. So the last part was the screw that holds the pin in the arm. I wanted to make this out of brass because not only does it look nice, it won't mar the pin when you decide to adjust the height of the pin. The screw had a knurled portion on it. I didn't use bacon grease for this because you want to use something that will flush the chips away. Knurling's a bit of a black art in the home shop. There's a few things you can do to make life a little easier on yourself. One of the things I found is actually to set the knurling tool over a little bit, not at 90 degrees, which seems a little bit counterintuitive, but it works very well for me. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. See you next time.